Good day to all of you, and thanks for joining our webinar here today. Today we're going to be talking about several subjects, but they're primarily going to be focused along the lines of communication in the production line, as well as storage of other data that come off of the production process. I'm going to give you a quick introduction to who Gopal Electronics is first, and then I'm going to throw it over to Sebastian Mueller from our Germany home office, who's going to get into some technical matters regarding today's subject. Sebastian, next slide, please.
So,
next slide, please, Sebastian.
Okay. 1 second. Seems to not work.
Aha. Click on it, see if it's selected. There we go. Oops.
Ah, perfect.
There we go. Go back one.
So.
There we go. Perfect. Sorry about that. Just getting things in order here. So just a quick profile of who Gopal Electronics is. We were founded in 1991. We've got a managed board comprised of a long legacy. Our founders actually came out of Carl Zeiss, which is headquartered in Jena, Germany, a very prominent area of optical technology in Germany. So a lot of experience, a lot of heritage with this company relative to these technologies. We do have branch offices in Austin, as well as the UK, China, and India. Okay, next slide, please, Sebastian. We're also well represented around the world with indirect offices, distributors, and partners. So regardless of where you are deploying technology in the world, chances are really good we'll be there to be able to support you. Sebastian, next slide. We have four primary business units. We do have automotive test technologies. We also have embedded JTAG solutions, industrial functional test, as well as inspection systems. With the embedded JTAG solutions, that's one of our primary products here in North America, along with our inspection solutions. Today's primary subject is going to be on the inspection equipment. Sebastian, next slide, please. Within our inspection product line, we have automated optical inspection, both 2D and 3D. We have automated 3D AXI and 2D AXI. We also have very capable 3D SPI systems for inspecting solder paste, and not only solder paste, but even more importantly, sometimes sinter paste today, which is much more challenging to inspect. Particularly if you have sinter paste processes in your production, you should talk to us because we have some very specific and very unique solutions for that. And then we also have an industrial visions solutions group, product group, which is really largely custom, allows us to integrate optical technologies within existing line elements such as test cells or solder machines, those kind of things. So with that, today's subject will be indirectly about this area. Very specifically, we want to talk to you about the data connection, not only between AOI, AXI, and SPI, for example, within the line, but also to higher level storage operations where you're storing data, results data, recovering it later, using it to improve the process down the line. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and throw it over to Sebastian to get started on the technical. We are going to have two surveys come up during the presentation. We'll have a question on each one of those surveys and take a look at your answers and see where that goes. We also should have some question for Q&A at the end. So with that, Sebastian, it's all yours.
Thank you very much, David. So yes, so just from my side, as a short introduction, my name is Sebastian Müller. I'm software team leader in a small team for creating software that is related to all the different inspection systems, so AXI, AOI, SPI, so like data connection to MES, like to share data between the systems, all this. So and today I'm going to talk about some technical details, of course, about some experience we made during the last years while implementing some connections to different systems, and to also show you some terms, or to talk about different terms and what they need. So first I want to start with two terms, horizontal and vertical communication. For this I have two examples for you to show the difference. Then I make a short categorization of different data that is created during a production process. Then possibilities how to share this data, to get the data from the inspection system to another system. I have some specific MES protocols, just short talking about this. And then I will explain our Pilot Connect plugin system to be able to to be free and communicate to different system MES systems and all this. And at the end I have a short application example for connecting data of different machines from different vendors, also our Pilot Supervisor software module. So I think we just start with the horizontal communication. As an example for this, I have here the new Hermes protocol. I think most of you heard about it. I think it was released already some years ago, 3 or 4 years. There was the first release of the first version of it. And this new protocol is for exchanging data regarding the board transportation within the production line. So the aim is to replace the old SMEMA standard that is very old. I think most of you will know it. You have this special cable here, so machines can communicate, and there's not a lot of possibilities. You can just hand over a board from one system to another, and data like serial numbers or the width of the board is not possible to transmit via this SMEMA. So in fact, it's needed to read a serial before every system, so before placement system, inspection systems, and so on. So of course, this is not the best solution, because a lot of failures can occur during serial read and so on. And the new SMEMA should replace this. So you have a lot of advantages with this. And just to show you how this works, how to replace this old SMEMA cable, the Hermes protocol uses TCP/IP communication with normal LAN that everybody has available in the production line. So no special cables are needed, and machines are just connected with a normal network. And then they are sending some XML messages. I have here one example for you. For example, the board available message as an XML. You can see this XML always begins one node with this angle bracket. Then you have the node, the name of the node. So this message is a board available message. And all data that is included here belongs to this message. So you can see, for example, here is a barcode included that is passed to the next machine. Also the width, so this can be used for automatic width adjustment. And another interesting thing you can see here is the board ID. So this is another unique identifier for the board. Normally you would say, okay, we have the barcode, this should be unique. But in fact, it's possible that you have the same board tested, for example, on one inspection more than this. So with this board ID, you can identify one of a board through the inspection line. So you put the board at the beginning of the line, then this board ID is generated. It's a 128-bit long number. So it's written as numbers to the base of 16. So we have not only 1, 2, 9 and the 0, we also have some letters A to F. So one digit can have 16 different values. And like this, you have at the end 128 bits. And this is a so-called GUID that is used a lot in software development to have ID that you can generate on any system, and you are sure that no other system will generate the same ID. So they don't have to communicate to make sure that this ID is unique. You just make such an ID and it's like a snowflake. It's really unique in the entire world. So, and like this, you can identify the board if it was removed or not. So this is also very helpful. So Hermes uses XML. So the specific schema is defined in the Hermes standard. So for example, that this node is called board available. This is defined in the Hermes standard. Also which properties are available here is defined in the Hermes standard. So like this, it's should be really plug and play. So if one vendor has developed such a connection, then it should work with other one. Of course, there are other messages than board available. There's a real handover. So if something goes wrong with board transportation, then both machines will notice this. So at the end, it's really clear when the entire process has finished, then that the board is in machine number two. So this is a short introduction to horizontal communication. So it's horizontal because all machines are on the same level. So there is no master, there is no slave, there is no server involved in this. So every machine can talk to the next machine to exchange this data. So, and now we will start our first survey, because I'm really interested in knowing if this new standard is in practice already or is in production. So I will hand over to David again to read the question.
Thanks, Sebastian. Our question for our first survey here is, Sebastian mentioned, we're really interested to see who is beginning to adopt Hermes already and would be very interested in your feedback. So the question is, are you already using the Hermes protocol productively? So are you incorporating Hermes already, or are you planning to? And thanks for your answers there.
Okay, we got the results.
Yeah, interesting. It looks like some haven't even heard of Hermes, which isn't that unusual, not too surprising. Hermes is relatively new. As Sebastian said, it's been rolled out for a couple of years now or so, but it's still, you know, slow to be discovered, especially slow to change over. However, it's becoming an increasingly important protocol, so important to pay attention to. Again, it looks like some of you are in the planning stages, so that's good. And some just have no plans to use Hermes. Sometimes if it's not broken, don't fix it. But it's still something important to look through into these days, because it can improve your productivity and effectiveness quite significantly. Another is our prediction is partially converted to Hermes already. So again, that's good to hear. And we have at least one that says they're fully switched to Hermes. So very interesting array of answers there. Not too surprising, like I say, 2% of you already using it. The rest either have plans or are just discovering it. So hopefully this webinar is really good timing for you on that. Thanks much.
Yes, thank you. For me, it's also interesting. We did the same webinar 2 weeks ago, just in German, and we had the same question here. There I had some more answers that production is partially converted or completely to Hermes. So I'm not sure right now, but I think it was about 15 or 20%, something like this. I know half year ago or 1 year ago, it was the same when I asked someone about Hermes. A lot of people heard about it, but not yet converted to this new standard, as there are, of course, some difficulties to convert to this because you need more than one system, or you need some conveyors that are talking this protocol. So, but I think so the last half year, it started that more and more are using this or switching to this. And I also know there are some companies providing solutions to upgrade old conveyors that don't have any capability to talk to TCP/IP protocol or something like this, to upgrade such conveyors and be able to fill this gap in your production line. So maybe this is also interesting for some of you, this information. But I'm really looking forward to see this more in production, because also the serial reading problem, yeah, it's sometimes difficult and not needed at the end. So we hope that this will go on. Okay, this was about the horizontal communication. And so now let's switch to the vertical communication. As I told before, for the horizontal, all machines were on the same level. They were talking to each other with no central server or something like this. For MES, this is different. So all the systems are talking just to one MES server and sending some requests and getting information from this central station. So this is why it's called vertical communication. And here the MES as an example. So the regarding the MES, I made a categorization of the data. So what data are produced during the production process. And we saw when someone adapts his inspection line to one central data acquisition, the first step in most of cases is to collect quality data of the product itself. So this is something like identifying the product with the serial number, and then you have the central storage to send data about the quality. So in our case of test equipment, it's just maybe the serial number and the total status, if the board passed or failed the test, and maybe the details of the failure, so which component failed and so on. So this is the first step we see when you connect your systems, to connect it to a quality management system. And you can also say product data acquisition to this. So most of the customers are using this step. And then when you go on and you want to be efficient also with smaller quantities of products, so you would need to change the program, for example, or you want to have process interlock, so to be sure that the board that enters a specific system is really allowed to enter it, and not that someone just put a board to this station and the board is not allowed. Then you have this second step, where normally the system will send a request with the serial number to the MES system, and the MES system will or the MES will give you the program name, for example, in the inspection for an inspection system, and if the board is allowed to enter the system. So this is normally the second step of data connection. And then the third step is also to transfer the data from the system. So it's not like in the first step about the product, but it's about the system itself. It's in standby, if it is waiting for material, are there some errors, for example, and someone has to come and resolve this error or something like this. So this is all about the machine itself. And related terms here is production data acquisition, or the equipment effectiveness, OEE. So this is the third step of connecting inspection systems. And this leads us to our next survey.
Yes, thank you, Sebastian. Our next survey is along the same lines, the question, but maybe a little bit lower level. We would like to know how many of you actually have your inspection systems connected to MES communication, or your inspection equipment at least is set up and has the capability for MES communication. So let us know what you're doing there. Okay, well, again, some interesting statistics coming back. Expected a little bit more, perhaps, in terms of adoption on this, and I think we see that here. Many said yes for quality data collection. That usually is the normal first step, and it's good to see 23% of you actually are using MES connectivity currently. 29 are using it for process control as well as data collection, which is exceptionally good. Data collection is perhaps a little bit newer, or not newer, but not always adopted as heavily, and then process control is secondly there, I think. For production data acquisition, 13% of you are currently using MES, and 29, though, say our inspection systems are not set up for MES, or 6% are saying we do not use inspection systems. So if you don't use inspection systems, you should contact us and let us talk to you about inspection systems as well. But with those stats, very interesting. And Sebastian, I'll let you take it.
Yes, thank you. And I just see that maybe we did a mistake here in this question, because I see one answer is possible for this question, and this question was intended to be able to have multiple selections. So of course, if you have quality data collection, then it's also possible that you have process control and production data acquisition additionally. So maybe this was our fault that we set up this survey not on the right manner. But I'm not sure, but I see one answer necessary. Maybe this was not correct. And this would also explain why we have process control 29%, and this is more than the data collection. This could be possible, but at the end, from my experience, there should be more data collection answers than process control. But I think this is because we did this in the wrong way. So sorry for this, but interesting anyway, a little bit. And I think we will go on. Okay. So this was about MES. Now we will go a little bit more in detail and talk about different formats, protocols, and how data is exchanged. So the easiest way to exchange data, and we saw this also in real life a lot, is to use simple CSV files, where you, in this example, you have only a timestamp here in the first row, then you have the serial and the status of the individual PCBs, for example. Of course, this could be more complex with more data, but at the end, it's just a flat list with separated values. So this is used from time to time to exchange data. Then we have another format we also saw with the Hermes, that is XML. That is more sophisticated because here you can have the data nested. You can have nested elements. So for example, here for the ZVEI protocol, we have our first node or our root node that is called unit data. So unit data is specification of this protocol. For the root element, then we have some properties here for this root element, like equipment, that tells you this was tested on the machine named test AOI, and here a timestamp when the inspection was done, and the overall state of the entire board, of the entire panel. Then you have sub nodes in XML. So for example, you can see it here, subunit data. This could be, in this example here, it's a individual PCB of the entire panel. And this can also have some properties and again, nested elements like this test steps here, telling you which component failed and what was the reason for the failure. So this is, so we can describe the data more in detail with this, and you do not only have a flat list of data, and every column or every row means the same. So this is, we see a lot in practice. Then a third format is JSON, that is similar to XML. So you can also have some nested data or some nested elements. It's not shown here in this element, but at the end you also have just a specifier. So old state here, this is an example of the IPC CFX. And after this, you have the value. So you do not have as much overhead as for the XML, because you only have the name of the property once. While in the XML, you have a lot of time, you have it double when the element is opened and then when the element is closed again. So, but both formats are readable for humans as well as for machines. So this means if someone reads such a message, you have to know what the 3000 means for the state, for example, for an inspection system. But this you can have a look in the IPC CFX specification, then you know it. And also the duration, this is clear. So if you read such a file or such a message over the network, for example, with the Wireshark tool, then human can read it and also machine can read it, because it's a fixed format. So it's clear what what properties are there, how they are called, and everybody who implements such a connection has to use exactly this names for everything. So this to the formats, and now to the way how the data is exchanged, for example, to an MES. The most common and easiest way is just to use a TCP socket. So because this is widely standard in use, and everybody has an Ethernet with IP and TCP available, and with this you can just send messages to a server, and the server will answer to your request. So it's most of the times it's that your system is a client and just will send data to the MES and just get a response from the MES back. I have here just an image of the TCP IP protocol stack, just for showing you how the different protocols are all using, in normal case, the TCP IP stack. So we have the Ethernet on the level one. So I have here also some terms that are related to the different layers, because it's interesting sometimes someone is confusing about all the different addresses and devices used on the different layers. So for the Ethernet, we have the MAC address for addressing the different systems, and the switch will forward all the Ethernet frame to the correct machine. Then on the second level, we have the IP. The IP layer with IP addresses, everybody knows, and router are just routing IP packets from one network to another, for example. And then we create a TCP connection on it, and for this we use a port. So this is just a specified number that your computer is talking for a specific protocol on the next layer. So for this we have a socket, a so-called socket, and all the communication goes via this TCP socket. For example, if you just open your browser and browse an internet website, then all this stack is used, and at the top HTTP protocol is used for transferring data describing the website, and the same is for IPC Hermes. It's also using the TCP and IPC CFX. So it's all using this standard that is now well established, and I think in fact there's no one using other protocol stack for this. But 20 or 30 years ago, it was not like this. So also these protocols had to make the way to get a real standards everybody uses. So, and at the moment, it's the same for the industrial 4.0 protocols like Hermes and CFX. So here I have an example how it's possible to just exchange one layer of this TCP IP protocol stack. For example, here there is an RFC. This is also a specification created by the Internet Task Force, Internet Engineering Task Force. And of course, this protocol is just for a joke, something like this. It's how you can exchange data not by Ethernet, but just sending data with a bird. So you just print out the message on a paper, and the bird will deliver the message. So at the end, it's possible to use HTTP or also Hermes or CFX. And at the bottom layer, you have this IP over avian carriers protocol, and the Hermes will not know about it, except for the long delay to get an answer, because they also tried out this protocol. So they send it some ping messages to another computer with this avian carrier protocol. And like you can see, we have 9 packets sent here, transmitted, 4 packets received, so 55% packet loss. And you have to wait 1 hour or 2 hours in maximum to get your answer. So maybe not the best for production systems, but just to show you how it's possible to exchange the different layers in this layer stack. So, and why I am talking about this birds, it's because in practice, we saw a lot of implementation for exchanging data from one system to another or to the MES that is using file exchange. So let's say we have a shared folder on a server, and then the inspection system just write a file in this folder, and the MES system will pull this folder and will look for new files, and then will process these files. And to send back answer, the MES will write back a file, and this file is processed by the inspection system. So there, it's used, I think, 20 to 30% of the implementation. It's used like this, and the argument is, it's clear and it's open. Everybody can look in the folder and can see the data. So it's easier to debug. But at the end, I think it's not a good way to do it like this, because you have additional delay in your communication, because you have to write it to a disk, and then it was, then you have some milliseconds delay until the MES will know that there are new files and all this. So at the end, you can also use network tools to see the communication, and it's not so good idea to use shared folders, especially when you have more than one system and you have 20 systems or 40 systems. This is no good advice to do it like this, in my opinion. I think so. So now let's come to some specific protocols we saw within last 5-6 years when we integrated such communication for our inspection system. So the SETV-EI protocol, I'm not sure if it's also in America used in Europe from time to time. Then we have protocols from MES software suppliers. So for example, ETAG has its own protocol, or AGES also. Then we have individual protocols from the customer itself. So if we have a customer and they have special needs, then they have an individual protocol, or have developed an individual protocol, and you have adapt to this protocol to exchange the data. OPC UA, I never saw within really for inspection systems. I heard a lot of it and that it's really good and everybody should use it. But in effect, there was no request from any customer to adapt to this. But I'm not sure, maybe this will come. And the last one, the IPC CFX protocol, is really new. And this claims to be the new standard and to be able to handle all data and requests for an entire production, not only for inspection systems. So this is really interesting, this new protocol, and that's why I will talk about a little bit about this new protocol, IPC CFX. So here I have just one sentence from the specification. So the CFX standard provides a true plug and play IoT communication environment throughout manufacturing, where all equipment, manufacturing processes, and transactional stations can communicate with each other without the need for the development and use of bespoke interfaces. So this sounds really good, and I really hope that this will come true, because at the end, what we do is developing a lot of interfaces for MES, and it's 95% of it's all the same, but with different names and with different order of messages. So I'm really hoping that this new protocol will grow and will be used a lot. And I will show you some details about this new protocol, what is specific, and also why I think it's a good protocol for exchanging all this data. The first difference to other protocols like ETAG or ZVEI is they are using a message routing system. So this is already developed. It's not for CFX developed. It's also used for other IoT application. It's called AMQP, Advanced Message Queuing Protocol. This is used by CFX, and it provides a publish subscribe system. So any endpoint like an inspection system or an MES server can publish some messages to this middleware, to this routing system, and other endpoints can subscribe to this, to specific topics, to specific data. And so everybody is able to not only to send data, but also to consume data. And I think this is a really good point here, that you can share the data among different systems, and you can grab the data of other system if it helps for your system to have benefits from this. So you have this publish subscribe system. Of course, the endpoints can talk to each other directly. So this would be the horizontal communication. This is also available. So this is the first big change, I think, to other standards. And then they have defined a lot of messages that can occur during the entire production, not only the testing, like the test inspection, but it's also about material storage, material transport, like you can see here. So on the left side, you see the different namespaces of the CFX specification. So this is the different topics that are covered by the CFX protocol. So it's not only used for inspection, but also for the production, for the storage. So I think there are plenty of messages, and all messages are well defined. So you have specific names and specific properties for all the messages defined. On the right side, you can see one example of such a message. Here it's just a message from any system that is able to read serial numbers of different individual PCBs. So we have here two units with different PCBs, and this message can be published to the message broker and can be consumed by other endpoints. So this is the format I spoke about before, JSON. So it's in JSON format, and it's using this AMQP messaging system, and this is using TCP/IP. So we have again the different stacks or the different layers that are used. And it's also a good idea, I think, from this standard, that it also uses a proven other protocol. So this is the AMQP. It's already in use. It's already defined. There is software available, also open source software, just to install such a broker that can deliver the messages, and they are using elements that are existing and that are working and that are proven. So it's also always good to not invite everything new, but to use existing things and just put on the top that information that you need. And in this case, it's the definition of all these messages. And yeah, so let's see how this will go on with the CFX. But I'm really also looking forward that this will change a lot of problems while adapting systems to production. So just as a reminder, if there are any questions also during the presentation, just write it in the chat, and David will just ask also during the presentation. There's no need to wait until we are finished. So if there are any questions to a specific topic, we are then just go on.
Sebastian, we do have a couple of questions if you'd like to try them.
Perfect.
We have one that's especially interesting. He asked, please expand on the value of partial conversion to Hermes. He says it feels like there's limited value if you're not fully integrated into an Industry 4.0 environment already. So what is the value outside the Industry 400 implementation?
The value of the Hermes?
The value of implementing Hermes without already being fully implemented on Industry 4.0 environment.
Yes, so you just can start with implementing Hermes without having any other communication, Industry 4.0 communication, just to get the advantage of this new protocol. So for transferring the boards, and also to have additional data transferred from one system to another. So if you switch from SMIMA to Hermes, then it's sufficient if you have one serial scanner at the start of your production line. This will scan all the serials, and then the serials can be passed via Hermes to all following stations. So, and with this, you can you don't need any serial reader on the other stations. So I think this is a big advantage. I think this is one of the most advantages. Of course, the other advantage that you can do automated width adjustment. So you only have to adjust the width on the first station, and then this can also be handled to the following stations. So there's no need to wait for other protocols or to say I'm waiting and I don't want to start with Hermes because maybe we can use CFX or something else, because CFX and Hermes are complementary. So you can also see Hermes is integrated now in CFX. It's different. It's different in technical. It's different because, for example, Hermes uses XML. CFX uses the JSON format, but you can use Hermes as standalone.
Thanks, Sebastian. One other quick one here, I think. It's a good time because it's specifically on CFX. One of our attendees asks how to get a work order by CFX.
A work order, what does this mean? David, can you explain maybe?
I am not sure, actually. I guess he means how to pull all of the data together for a given product, I would think. Requirements, test requirements, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay, so every system in the production line can send messages via CFX. For example, the inspection system, so we implemented this So it's also, maybe I should have mentioned this before. If you implement CFX, you will not implement all the messages, because of course, if you have a specific system for testing boards, then you will not implement some messages like material storage or something like this. So if you say I have implemented CFX, you have to say exactly what namespaces you have implemented and maybe also what specific messages you have implemented. So let's say for the test and inspection, there are messages, for example, for the quality data I mentioned before. So when the board has finished the inspection, then there is a CFX message containing all the quality data of the entire board, also including details, which component failed, which pin. And this is the only open point, I think. So it's all well-defined messages, but there are a lot of, I think, optional fields that maybe you can feed the data to these fields, but it's not necessary. So you have also to specify what data you are providing. So for the test, you would only send, the board is tested, I will publish this message, and whatever system is interested in this message, this can be the MES server, of course, that wants to collect all the data to store it to a database and to have it available. But it can also be something like a dashboard, just showing some first pass yield statistic in your production. So it's like an open system where you can publish messages and other system can consume the data.
Thanks, Sebastian. I should mention at this point also, we're running a little bit short on time. So if we don't get to your question, be sure to follow up with us. You can contact Sebastian directly or contact us through Gopal.com. If you're in North America, it'll end up back with me. And we'll also be following up with you. So if we don't get to your question, don't worry, we'll follow up with you and get back to you. Sebastian, would you like to continue at this point or another question?
Yes. Yes, we can continue. Good advice that we only have 7 minutes, but I think we are good. So I go on and then we should be fine. So next point about the experience we made during the last years. So how are we able to connect all our different inspection systems? So we have SPI, AOI, AXI systems to the different MES. So this is what my team does. We are writing some specific MES plugins. So it's just some code or some DLL for the specific communication to your system. And then all the systems, may it AXI, AOI, SPI, is able to use this plugin. So they don't need to make some changes in their software because we have a common interface for all these systems. So they are not involved in implementing connection to the MES. They are always using the same interface and we have the plugins. So you just have one folder with some DLLs you put on your system and then you have this specific MES connection available for your system. So far, we developed 47 different plugins. 26 of these plugins had process lock or program selection available. For 7 plugins, they were using data exchange via the file system. That was this with the bird I told you. And 14 plugins have production data acquisition. So this is also interesting. I think some examples of specific protocols is ZBEI protocol, ETAG we implemented, Aegis, SexGem. There we have another software tool that converts all the messages, because this is really complex one. And CFX, we implemented 1 month ago. So we are also ready for using CFX right now. So in 95% of our cases, development time for a new plugin is between 1 and 4 weeks. 4 weeks is for some special cases where it's really difficult communication. The normal case would be 1 or 2 weeks if it's a new protocol. So of course, if it's already developed like ETAG or something, there may be no effort, but for specific implementation, 1 or 2 weeks is the normal case. Important for short development time. So if you have your own protocol, for example, is a good specification. So if we got a good specification that is well-defined, then we can develop the plugin very shortly. And another point is it's also possible to test a new plugin within your production environment already before the system is delivered. That is important to be able to start the production very shortly. So if you have, for example, remote connection, then we can just install the new plugin and have some software that is emulating an inspection system. And like this, we can test a new plugin already before the system is delivered. Or also with a VPN connection, this would be possible. So this was all about MES, our plugin system, CFX, and so on. And for the last 2 minutes, I have just one application example, how we integrate data from different vendors. And this is our software module Pilot Supervisor. To start with this, I have here a image of an inspection line where you have SPI, AOI, AXI, and some of these systems are green. That should mean that these systems are not Grippl systems, but from other vendors. So like the most of you will know, then you have some verification software and a verification station after every inspection system. So an operator will see some images and has to decide if it's a real failure or not. So we had one customer with a request to us that was using 69 inspection systems of different manufacturers, different vendors, and he wanted to be able to verify all the data from a central station. So we wanted to use one software, and the first problem for this was that all the systems from the different vendors have different data formats. Some are writing the data to files, some are writing to databases, and so on. And for this, we implemented some importers. So this is just a small software module reading the data of the vendor and importing it to our Pilot Connect database. And when we have this done, then all the data is in the same format. So also the images and the CAT data and all this, and you are able to use the same software within your entire production. So now it would be possible to use the same software on every station, but the goal was to replace our 4 verification station within the production line and just have 1 verification station on a central place to be able to verify the data. So we just put the verify station out of the production line and place a conveyor on this position that is able to communicate via TCP/IP. So if now a board comes out of the system, then the conveyor will send a request with a serial to our Pilot Connect system. And if it was a fail board, then the board is lifted and the operator on the supervisor station will see the result and can verify the data. If it's a false call, for example, then the message goes back to the conveyor and the and the board will go on in the production line. So now you have less equipment, you have less work for the operator within the production line. There's just one station. And it's also possible to verify the data from different vendors. So the software looks like that. You have just your systems or your conveyors that also can be some buffers or something like this. If you want to buffer more than one board, then you can also connect buffers. The operator will click such a buffer and will see the data of the loaded board within this buffer. So then he will see the data on the central station, and this works really good, and you have all these advantages I mentioned. So now if you have a lot of systems, it may be necessary to have more than one such station. So for example, here we have two stations. They all getting the data, the same data from the different stations. And so the operators can share the workload of the of the verification. It's also possible with this to combine the data from different inspection systems. For example, here we have the view of the verify software with data from the SPI. So we have the solder paste process. We see the AOI images here on the bottom side, and we also see the AXI image. And like this, it's easier to determine on what position in the production a specific failure may be occurred. So for all these 96 inspection systems of 5 different vendors, at the end, there were only 4 verification stations necessary. So you can handle all the workload with 4 or maximum 4, with 3 or 4 operators all working on a central station. This just as a last example for the benefit of connecting data, of having it in a common format and to be able to write software with new possibilities using this connected data. So that was the last slide of my presentation. We are at the end.
Thanks much, Sebastian. That was really great. A lot of information here in this presentation, obviously, and we're in a little bit short of time, but great delivery. A lot of information. Keep in mind that we're always happy to work with you to help you understand what would be required to implement these techniques in your particular situation, and help you understand the value for your particular situation too. So if you have questions, please follow up with us. As I mentioned, we'll be following up with you also. So I hope to hear from you and talk to you soon. Thank you much.